All right. Good morning, everybody. It's morning for me. I'm not sure what time it is for you, but thank you so much for joining our virtual CEU. It is an interesting world that we are all living in today. I hope you're all safe and healthy. I do miss the ability to be in a room with all of you so that we can have this discussion together. But I'm glad that you would take time out of your day to join us for this virtual session today. Today, what we want to talk about is something that we've been referring to as this idea of your home being your castle, and how smart home technology can help you and your clients really build their home into something that is a really important space for them. It already is, but how can we use technology to help make it an even better sanctuary for them? And I think that today, now more than ever, this is an important topic. So first off, I'm Brad, Brad Hinsey. I'm a VP Marketing at Control4. We'll be going through this conversation today. Now, if you have any comments or questions during the session, please drop them into the chat and we'll do our best to address them as we go throughout the session. Now, we've all seen a tremendous increase in the popularity and the availability of smart home devices. We've seen this tremendous curve in terms of adoption among consumers for this technology. There's a lot of promise that these products bring to various households. In a really rapid curve, we've seen that just in the last 3 years, 30% of US households have added a smart home device. Many of these you're likely familiar with. Some of them might be a little bit more obscure, but it's clearly a trend that is picking up momentum. That's because the devices are exciting, they're interesting, they offer very novel functionality, and they bring together a lot of promise and benefit for the homeowners that are living there. But this also means that your homeowners are likely beginning to ask you about how to incorporate technology in their lifestyle. That's the reason for us to have this discussion today. Over the next while, we're going to see over 60 million different homes become smart and connected. While so many homes have at least one connected device, the reality is the trends are going toward everything being connected. There are the obvious examples that we're all familiar with: voice assistants, comfort control systems, door locks are becoming more prevalent, and there's so much value that they provide. But then we're starting to get into a territory where there are a lot of other things too that may or may not be quite so obvious. So, for instance, your appliances are getting smarter, and sometimes you might question, well, what's the value of that smart? Then you also get down to the extreme of, we're hearing of things like smart and connected salt and pepper shakers. I have no idea what you would ever use a smart and connected salt and pepper shaker for. Maybe it buzzes after the third time you shake salt on your dinner or something. Who knows? But the reality is there are so many individual devices that are getting more intelligent. They're getting smarter. They're offering these benefits. But the reality is that creates a lot of noise confusion. One smart thing cannot really be compared to another smart thing. The reality is that it's really easy to call something smart, but it's much harder to actually deliver on that. And so one of the things that we want to talk about today is a way to approach and evaluate the technology that you might recommend to your customers and your clients so that you might make the best recommendations and have an informed view on what this technology is and what it could be. One of the things that we want to talk about is something that we call the difference between individual smart accessories and a smart home. While many of the things that are becoming smart and connected today are really brilliant. They offer really great functionality and features. The downside is that they're kind of designed to just be a one-off device or an accessory that's an afterthought, right? Something that you just put on the counter, something that you put on a shelf, and you use when you use it. But it's not really purpose-built for the home to become an infrastructure or a permanent piece of the home. And so what we want to do is kind of cut through some of the noise that some of these smart accessories create, and talk about how we can create a really great smart experience for your clients and for, you know, individuals interested in adding and using technology to enhance their life. So we have this, we've kind of built a way of approaching technology around this notion that your home is your castle. And we've developed a list of four things that we think are required if you want to turn your home into a smart castle. And so as you approach technology, use these four things as a starting point to begin to understand whether you should or shouldn't recommend this to your client and whether it will actually meet their needs. So one of the very first things, I think this one's probably one of the most obvious, a smart home as a smart home castle has to be helpful. It has to help the family and those that live there live a better life, have a better lifestyle. Second, you know, just like your home is uniquely personal to that family, your smart home castle should also be uniquely personal and enhance the unique lifestyle and the unique interests of the family that lives there. Third, has to be secure. And this is, I think everybody is becoming more and more acutely aware of how to the need to protect your home, particularly as you begin to open up some of the technical or some of the technology and exposing it to the rest of the internet and the rest of the world. It has to be secure so that you're protecting the family. And then fourth, it has to be private. And I think this is another area where we're all beginning to become more sensitive to the realities of, you know, we're generating loads and loads of data, and this is our most private space. And we generate a lot of data, and we can generate a lot of data in there. And is our smart home castle working for us, or is it working against us in this regard? So let's drill into each of these four areas. First, a castle is helpful. And one of the things that, you know, we think about in terms of being, you know, having a home be helpful, is this notion of what we call scenes. And scenes are things where we can orchestrate across the home many things to make my life easier or better. So a really good example, and this is something that I live with, and I love, and I don't think I could ever live without, it's this notion of a welcome home. When I come home at night, the porch lights, they're always on. I don't have to think about it. They turn on with the sun set, and they turn off at a certain hour that I have scheduled. But more importantly, when I open the garage door as I arrive home, so the house is lit, the outside is lit, I open the garage door, and I walk in the kitchen, and the kitchen lights are already on. And so I'm welcomed home into my space with lights so that it's not dark. I can see everything. I'm not stumbling or I'm not tripping over anything. And that just adds so much to my peace of mind and to my comfort. And it seems like a small thing, but it really, really has a lot of those peace of mind benefits. Good morning is a very similar type of activity, but it's across various different parts of the home. You know, so for families and those with children in various rooms, you can schedule good morning so that you're gently waking children up, whether that's the lights raising or shades raising, the temperature adjusting, maybe starting with soft music and then slowly increasing the volume so that people kind of gently brought into being awake rather than being forced to abruptly wake to your alarm. Another one that is super powerful, and I think that, again, it sounds very simple, but it is very has so much benefit to everybody. To the family that lives there is this good night scene. In a good night scene, you know, all the lights in the home are shut down. The front door is locked. The garage doors are closed. You know, for me personally in my home, the shades in the master bedroom have already come down at sunset. And so these are all different lifestyle scenes that can help help you feel more comfortable in your home and help you know, have that peace of mind that comes from having, you know, things work for you and work on your behalf. And so a smart home, a helpful home, will coordinate individual products or individual parts of our homes into complete solutions. And so when you approach smart home technology, many accessories might do a singular thing really well, maybe turn on the air conditioner or maybe turn on the heater in a really smart and intelligent way. But a smart home will actually coordinate all of those things across the home, leveraging your lighting with your home security, your audio and video you can control from your phone or from a handheld remote. Use voice control when your hands are full. And then, of course, you have a solid network that's running all of these things and bringing them all in and orchestrated together. So a couple of things to look for when you're evaluating smart home technology and trying to see whether it's actually helpful or not. One is scenes. Are you able to coordinate devices across the home to create these kinds of scenes or lifestyle experiences that are really, truly helpful? Or is it limited to, you know, the functionality of a singular accessory? Second, more terminology that's helpful when you're talking about this kind of capability is the ability to integrate multiple things together. Can your lighting and your HVAC system and your security system and your audio system, are they integrated and orchestrated together? Are they talking together? And so scenes and integrations are very important things to look for when you're considering smart home technology and really using creating this smart home castle. All right, so now let's jump into personal. I think this is clearly one of the most obvious things, but achieving it is, I think, the challenge. We all know that our homes are our most personal spaces, and many of your clients hire you to create a uniquely personal space. But achieving that using technology also can seem a little bit counterintuitive, though it's not actually all that different from your own design backgrounds. First of all, technology, while it's bringing all of these new capabilities and all of this promise and these benefits, it also is introducing a lot more complexity into our lives. If you think about a smart home that has today, you know, a lot of people have 1 to 3 to 5 smart devices. But when you get to the level where you're really creating this super helpful smart home, you're getting into the numbers of 50 and 100. We even have customers that have over 1,000 connected devices. And so while there's a lot of benefit there, that can potentially introduce complexity for your customers. And your customers, they want simplicity. They want the benefits and they don't want the hassle. They don't want to deal with firmware upgrades and software changes and usernames and passwords for a huge variety of devices inside of their home. They just want the benefits. Now, the corollary that you may be familiar with is the reality is that nobody paints their own home anymore. If you were to go shopping at a local home improvement store, you might assume that everyone paints their homes because there's all these brushes, there's these various paint colors and all these brands of paint, and it seems so simple. But the reality is that 90% of people hire a professional to paint their homes. And it's not because it isn't something that's approachable, it's just because they don't want to do that. And what we see in smart home technology, and we've seen it in consumer electronics for the last several decades, is there are a lot of promises for homeowners about it being simple and that you can do it on your own. And while there are many capabilities and many things you could do on your own, the reality is that we actually want more of more support there. We want more professionals. And so DIY is not actually delivering what homeowners actually want and need. And part of the challenge that, you know, is making that clear is DIY tends to create a situation where we end up with a million different accessories on the wall. And, you know, we call it wall acne. It's just terrible. It looks awful on the wall. But the other challenge is that each accessory has its own way of being configured. Each accessory has its own username and password. And the experience is kind of disjointed. The other problem is that only the nerd in the household uses that technology or knows how to use it. But when you use a professional to help you, much like you do in the design world, when you have a technology professional help, you can get away from this wall acne. You can have a more secure experience. Everything is integrated together and it's purpose built and it's built into the home and it becomes a part of the infrastructure of the home rather than this kind of accessory that gets double stick taped onto the wall or just left on a shelf. And so one of the ways actually to achieve a personal smart home is to use a smart home professional, somebody that can help guide you through the process, be your partner, much like you are a consultant for your clients on a design perspective, smart home professionals. And they range the whole gamut, not just audio video. It's lighting, it's security, it's comfort control, and increasingly so, it's also networking as well. So when you're looking for a smart home professional, some of the characteristics to look for, one, are they CEDIA certified? CEDIA is a trade association of technology professionals that can help create these experiences for you and for your clients. The next thing to look for is, do they have experience managing and administering residential networks. It is increasingly more important every single day to have a rock solid network inside of the home. And these professionals can help ensure that. The consumer grade networking equipment that many homeowners have today, just because that's what they were provided by their ISP or some other place, it just won't cut it for, you know, a fully connected home. And many people are beginning to really understand that as we all do more from our homes as well. But look for and ask about their ability to integrate and automate things from across the home, whether it's lighting or comfort or security or audio and video. And then ask them for examples of high quality projects that they've done. And make sure that you develop a relationship with them so that you can trust them. But we also recommend that you know several of these types of professionals, much like you might work with a variety of subcontractors today that might be in the same trade. You know, you can call them for different types of projects. Develop a relationship with more of those. You can go to CEDIA.org and find a list of professionals in your area. Control4.com also has a list of professionals in your area. Build a relationship with them so that you can call on them when you have clients that have these kinds of questions. Now, one of the things that we hear frequently from design professionals, but also from homeowners too, particularly those that have had some iteration of technology in their home in the past, is that, you know, I don't want to call a professional every time I want to make a tweak or a change to my home. And so another aspect of a personal smart home is, you know, the ability to retain control, to personalize the way the technology functions inside of the home. Some of the routines, you know, our lives change, our routines change, our tastes change in terms of music playlists and things like that. And so you want a smart home system that is, you know, supported and installed by professionals, but also gives those that live there, those that understand how it should function the best, gives them the control to be able to personalize it and make the changes that they need so that the home really fits their world. So one of the things that is really important in terms of making a home really personal is providing many different ways to use the technology. And this, again, if you pay attention to some of the consumer trends, you might assume, you know, in the, you know, a few years ago, it was all about, oh, you know, control your home only from your phone. In the last 3 or 4 years, it's been control your home only with your voice. And those are very important and very useful interfaces. They're indispensable. But you cannot have a system that relies only on mobile or only on voice control, because then the family is limited in those that can use it. And it's just plain not convenient. And so having a personal smart home means having a variety of ways that I can use the technology. So it's comfortable for you. It's comfortable for the family. That includes things like keypads that replace your traditional light switches, in-wall or tabletop touchscreens. A universal remote when you sit down to watch TV is by far the most convenient and most intuitive interface. And then, of course, voice control when your hands are full, or you just want to start a playlist really simply. But of course, then your smartphone is best when you're scrolling through playlists, when you're away from your home, maybe when you're viewing camera footage, or you want to talk to somebody who's at the front door without actually opening the front door. And so a personal smart home provides all of this variety and choice for a family. So it makes it very easy for them to use the technology and very convenient. So a couple of things to keep in mind as you evaluate whether technology can deliver a very personal smart home. First, there should be a variety of interfaces. If the technology you're looking at works only through voice or only through mobile, it's not going to create a personal smart home for you. Might be a totally fine accessory, but it won't be a smart home. Second, programming through your professional can help achieve some of those scenes and some of the helpful lifestyle interactions that we talked about before. And you know, you as a client, as a you know, an advocate for your client, can help develop what that programming might look like. But it must also be something that your customers can modify and change and make personal on their own too. Third, open platform. This is, I think, a really an important aspect of providing or creating a very personal smart home. The ability for a client to choose their favorite devices and have a lot of choice in terms of what gets connected, rather than limiting them to a short list of the products that are supported within any sort of ecosystem. And then lastly, a smart home professional. They are your guides through this process. Involve them, you know, build a relationship with them. Involve them in the process as soon as you can. And they can really help make it a truly personal and well-functioning smart home. All right, next, a smart home castle is secure. I think, you know, the first part of this discussion, we have to talk about the reality. And this, you know, we talked about this last year before the pandemic hit, but this is even more true now. You know, I think that we have redefined Maslow's hierarchy of needs, where before physiological needs, food, water, shelter, and warmth were the most basic needs of all. The reality is today, Wi-Fi is actually the most basic need for any of us. Now, that's a little flip, but what we know is the Wi-Fi in a home today is very important for us as we work in our homes, as we teach our children in our homes, as we try to relax and enjoy our lives in the evenings and whenever, and as we try to connect with our families and that are outside of the home. Wi-Fi is one of the most important elements to staying connected today. And a smart home puts even more importance on that network. As you get 30, 40, 50, 100 different devices in your home, the network begins to take much more of that load on. And so you know, a lot of families have this one little Wi-Fi modem thing that they got from their internet service provider, and it just won't cut it for delivering that kind of thing. But a professional can really set up an infrastructure grade network so that your network becomes as reliable and as robust as the typical utilities that we're all familiar with, right? It should be no different than your power. It should be no different than your water or your gas. You know, networks should be that reliable and always on. And a pro can really help ensure that you have a robust, solid, reliable network. But another important element of having a secure network or having a professional help is to keep it secure, keep the software up to date, keep the all of the settings configured properly, and to keep people out of the home and to keep the family connected. And so in these ways, you can protect the family through with a professional, you can protect them through the network. But a smart home can also help secure the family by giving them access and control to be able to see who's at the front door, for instance, to keep the front door locked and to keep windows and doors closed, or at least know when they're, you know, just the current state of your home. And so a smart home castle will help a family feel like they can really take control of the security of their home. So one of those ways that you do it is while away, you know, using away from the home, the ability to use your mobile phone to check on how the house is doing, whether there's somebody there or not. Turn lights on and off. Maybe create something that we call mockupancy, where lights are turning on and off as if you're home, even though you're not. So that it gives the appearance of somebody being there. But also features like having a video doorbell, where when somebody comes to the front door, you can see them and you can talk to them, but you don't need to open the front door, provides a tremendous amount of peace of mind and security for the family. Another, and this is one that I live with in my home and I totally love it now. I can't see my front door from my family room or from my kitchen, just the way that my floor plan works. But I can look across the room on a keypad and I can see a little green light or a little red light. And that light tells me just at a glance whether my front door is locked or it's unlocked. And you know what that light means to me is, you know, peace of mind for my family, knowing that we're secure. And I haven't had to walk to the front door to check on that. And so a smart home can also deliver these the security to the family as well. So a couple of things to keep in mind when you're talking about smart home technology and keep making it secure. Passwords and management by a smart home professional to really lock down the network and create a situation where you're keeping people out, but you have all of the benefits of this connected technology. And then, of course, providing remote access to your home so you can check in on it. You can check in on the family. You can make changes and do anything like that you need is all an important element of creating a secure smart home. All right. Lastly, a smart home castle is private. And there we often or people often talk about security and privacy together, but they're very different things and it's very important. One of the things that I think we need to think about in terms of smart home technology is asking the question, what do you do with my data? Do I have control over that data? Am I automatically broadcasting my data somewhere else? And, you know, I think that, you know, on the surface, some people might say, well, I don't care if a big corporation knows that I turned the light switch on in my bathroom at 1 a.m. in the morning. But the reality is that in aggregate, while that one singular data point may not be super invasive, the reality is if you track that data over time and they see, oh, well, this person gets up at 1 a.m. every night, you know, and uses the restroom, well, maybe we need to pump ads to them for this certain medication, or there are health implications, or, you know, there are all kinds of data privacy implications that can crop up when we have 100 different connected devices inside of our homes. So as you approach technology, ask about privacy. What do they do with the data? Do I have control to turn that data flow off? Or is that the whole reason that you're giving this product to me for so cheap is because we're trading data for it. And so look for that kind of transparency, that kind of control so that you can understand whether or not that technology is something that you want to bring into your home. So there are two pieces of the privacy discussion that I think are very important. One is the identity. When you have 100 different devices inside of your home, do you have to set up and create an identity for each of those 100 devices? Does that give away who you are to all of these other companies? And then what happens with the usage data as I go throughout my home? I think that many of us learned this in the early days of the mobile devices and then mobile apps, and they were tracking all of our GPS. And at one point, it's like, I don't really care if it knows where I'm going. And then people started to see those horror stories of how lives were mapped out on a map and you could be tracked at any moment. And I think that the same is now occurring for our homes. And so we need to be aware and attuned to the conversation about our private data inside of the smart home. All right, so these are the four dimensions of, you know, really making a smart home castle that I think are very important to discuss with your client and to discuss with the smart home professional. Is it helpful? Is it personal? Is it secure? Is it private? So now let's talk about how we believe it's necessary to achieve this. And one of the things that, and this is admittedly a little geeky, but you know, your smart home castle needs an operating system in the same way that your computer, your phones, you know, frankly, even our cars have operating systems. And what this operating system does is it takes the functionality of individual pieces and parts, whether those are sensors or processors or memory or, you know, other, you know, like your camera and all of those things, and it makes it really simple and easy to use. And it takes out all of the complexity for the homeowners. And so one, you know, we've kind of broken down what we mean by smart home OS or what it can do with a couple of things. So first of all, a smart home OS unifies everything inside of the home, connects your security system, your lighting, your cameras, your audio and video, your comfort system. All of that is unified into a singular system that you can use. And then you can create those scenes that we were talking about earlier. A smart home operating system is designed to be infrastructure. Just like we talked about the utilities that we've all come to rely on, power, water, gas, you know, these capabilities need to blend into the home and need to be reliable, need to be purpose built into the home so that we can rely on those. And so a smart home operating system functions as infrastructure, understands the role of the technology being important infrastructure inside of the home. Third, choice and simplicity. A smart home operating system shouldn't lock families into a very narrow list of products that can be used inside of that ecosystem. Rather, they should give them the choice of the very best products so that they can bring in the mix that is the most important to them. But then it also should be simple for everyone in the family to use, not just the nerd, not just the person that loves technology. And you achieve that simplicity by providing a variety of interfaces, whether that's mobile, whether that's voice, touchscreen, or keypad. Lastly, a smart home a smart home operating system also embraces the role of privacy, protects the privacy of the family by default. And then finally, a smart home operating system is designed to be installed and supported by professionals. It provides the professionals with the tools they need to be able to deliver this kind of an experience for the family while also giving the family the ability to make it personal and change it for the family that they need. So as a smart home operating system unifies everything across the home to create those lifestyle experiences, provides the choice with a broad ecosystem of supported and integrated devices. Some of the smart home accessories that you see out there in the world today, they talk about, you know, the integrations that they offer, but sometimes it's embarrassingly small, 15, 20, 30 devices. When we all know that our homes are a unique collection of the devices that we prefer and that we like to use. And so your smart home operating system should have that same breadth and choice as well. And then it also must deliver that simplicity so that everyone in the family can use and interact with the technology in the most convenient way. And the, you know, one of the things that's important to consider when you look at things like keypads and touchscreens and universal remotes, those are the kinds of devices that even a guest that's never been in your home can approach and they can feel somewhat comfortable and intuitively use so that they feel welcome inside of the home. A mobile phone and voice control is a device or an interface that really only certain individuals in the family can really feel comfortable using. And so having a mix of these interfaces is really important to be able to create that kind of smart home that's approachable for everybody. We already talked about the smart home professional and the tools that they can use to install and support this smart home OS. So your customers deserve more, your clients deserve more than what they're getting today from smart home accessories. And hopefully this discussion that we've had today about how you might evaluate and approach technology, how you think about it, some of the questions that you might ask, will help you help provide enough knowledge to help break it all apart so that you can lead the way with technology and help guide your clients to delivering some or living in some of these smart home castles. So this is my contact information. You can reach out to me, email me, you can visit control4.com to learn more about Control 4. But there's also a lot of content about these kind of smart home operating system and many, many projects and examples of people who are living with this technology today. All right. So thank you so much for joining. We hope that this has been useful. We'd love to hear your feedback on what you felt was the most helpful, most useful in ways that you might like to learn more about the technology so that we can make it even more useful as well.